And welcome back to some more Torment Tides of Numenera. I'm the RPG Chick, and this is the Cult of the Changing God, Casmeen and Mimeon, and a big machine. Hail! As you approach the duo, you see that they are arguing heatedly, but quietly. The petite woman turns toward you. Her hair is unusual, a light, almost yellow color, and her bright eyes dominate her pretty face. "Excuse me, my lady. My friend and I were having a discussion, and..." Her eyes fall upon your tattoo, and her breath catches audibly in her throat. She thinks, "A cast-off. One I've never seen." Her partner is an unnaturally tall man, gaunt and sour-faced, his voice sonorous, with fingers that twitch and weave through strange contortions. Occasional light sparks in the air as he does. He turns to you and opens his mouth to speak, registers your tattoo, and closes it again. His throat bobs for a moment, and he says, "It is an honor." Calistair sighs. "Must we indulge in this religious nonsense?" Mimeon says, "Your opinion of our beliefs is noted. We have discussed our differences with you, and you made your position quite clear, thank you." He turns back to you, anger stretched on his face, or etched on his face. He collects himself. "If I might impose on your time for a moment, will you tell me about your tattoo? How did you shape it? Do you know why it differs from the others?" He thinks, "I'm having trouble placing her. Could it be any more time to question her?" "What do you mean, shape it? Don't tattoos stay the same?" "Not yours, revered one." Casmeen's voice is the barest whisper as she curtsies. "You are a cast-off of the changing god, light of brilliance. His touch is on your head. The tattoo marks you as his child." She gazes at you, enrapt. "You are not alone. Other cast-offs live, and we treasure each of you." Mimeon says, "You are welcome here, revered one. We stand ready to serve as we can. Have you any questions for us?" "Can you tell me about the meaning of this tattoo again?" He bows. "You are a cast-off of the changing god, our inspiration, the man who has cheated death for centuries so that he might accumulate wisdom. He wears bodies like clothes and abandons them when he has exhausted his studies in them. Yet when he leaves, a spark of consciousness remains. Your consciousness, revered one." "Who are you?" He considers your words before answering. A thoughtful pause. "I am Mimeon. I am one of the leaders of the Cult of the Changing God in Sega's Cliffs, and my primary duty is as Chief Archivist. My colleague is Casmeen. She is responsible for the day-to-day administration of our encampment." "What can you tell me about the city?" "The city your sire built and defended? The cradle of civilization? The center of the Empire of Knowledge?" His eyebrows raise. Or rise, sorry, and his low tone is effusive. "It is among the great works of humanity in the Ninth World, built on the foundations laid by unknown creators. It has risen to become one of the preeminent cities on Garavia Sound." He pauses. "It is somewhat diminished in these latter years, to be sure. Perhaps if the changing god were to return to lead us to glory." "Can you tell me anything more about the city?" "Many thousands of souls call Sega's Cliffs their home. They came here for safety, for succor, and the Changing God protected them. Now you can visit the spires of Government Square, where he once sat, or the places where his machines once shifted the city out of time. Your sire even faced a bloom when he was here." She represses a shiver. "But you should avoid it at all costs. There is much else to do in the city if you want to walk in your sire's footsteps." "Tell me anything more?" "The same." "Okay. Do you know anything about the sorrow?" She shudders, Casmeen, and touches herself ritualistically on the forehead and on her lips. "A monster of deepest nightmare. I have heard that it wants you dead. Every one of the Holy One's creations, all dead. I don't know why, but it hates you." "Can you tell me anything else about it?" Mimeon nods somberly, raising a finger to his forehead. only that it is remorseless, pitiless, and it wants nothing more for the destruction of you and all those who, like you, were created by your sire. What can you tell me about my sire? Casmeen says, you mean the most accomplished inventor of our time? The hero of Sagus Cliffs? The man who dodged time itself? The time weaver? The man who destroyed the Tabat? Yeah, that guy. Oh, we have so much to say, she catches herself. But perhaps we should wait for another time. Really? Can you try to tell me about him again? An inspiration to inventors and seekers after knowledge, rather than meekly accepting his impending death and the immeasurable loss to posterity his passing would have occasioned, he found a way to continue his work. He is a model for those of us who value wisdom and insight. Do you know anything about a device called a resonance chamber? Mimeon says, rumor and conjecture, nothing more. Idle speculation from those who wish to pretend to knowledge of your sire's motivations, passed along as fact. He leans out to touch you. Have you seen it? Do you know where it is? What it does? I don't know anything about the resonance chamber, but I was told you might. He smiles slightly and spreads his hands in apology. Not as much as I should like, but we have ways to find answers. His eyes trawl your face, and it seems as if he is on the verge of understanding something. It is said by those loyal to your sire that the chamber is the solution to the sorrow, the creature that hunts you all. He thinks, I'm certain now. We haven't met this one yet. We don't know how, though. Casmeen bows her head slightly. We take this as an article of faith. The resonance chamber will save you. Mimeon looks sharply at you now, all distraction gone. I do not recognize you, he says. You do not match any descriptions we have recorded. Casmeen snaps her fingers, as if she is finally figuring out a mystery. Wait, let me remember your face. She studies you carefully. You're new. Are you the changing god? Can it be? She reaches out to touch your sleeve and pulls her hand back quickly. No, I'm not the changing god. Mimeon nods, satisfied. As I thought, you are a cast-off, one of his children. He touches you with his long-fingered hand as if in constellation. These guys keep touching me. There is no shame in such a thing. Many cast-offs have come to our attention, and some of them have sought to deceive us so that they may seem more important. He smiles softly. If you are as new as we suspect, it is better for you, for us, to know the truth of your existence than to bluster and lie. Crestfallen, Casmeen touches her shoulder. So touchy-feely. Are you sure you're not... She catches herself. No. Why would you lie about that? With a noticeable effort, she wrenches herself into optimism, and she chirps. But you're new, aren't you? You're new. Have you decided what you'll do? What you'll be? Your sire's other children have done amazing things. Amazing. And no doubt you will as well. Mimeon lays a hand on her shoulder, and his voice is low. Cautionary. Kaz. She looks away from you for a moment, swallowing sudden tears, and he says, We have a request for you. Mimeon gestures toward the clock behind him. Dark figures circumambulate these clock faces. I theorize that your sire's creation of the time shield that protected this city established a connection with his future selves. Given this, we believe these figures may be cast-offs, or ghosts of cast-offs, perhaps, the living shells of the bodies your creator has worn previously. Mimeon's figures shrug eloquently for him. The clock is unmoored in time, you see. We do not have a knowledge sufficient to investigate, but you might. You have a connection with he who created the clock. You should be able to align it with the present time and uncover who these figures are. A gentle, rare smile appears. If you cannot, at least you will increase our store of knowledge. Casmeen smiles bravely, looking between Mimeon and you, and says, And then we can answer the questions you may have. Right, Mim? Do you have any idea how to fix the clock? We have tried, Mimeon says, I have appealed to the Order of Truth. I have spoken with imminent seekers of knowledge. We have sent for wisdom from as far as the steadfast. A great achievement, you must agree. None have given us an answer. We believe your sire created the device, or had a hand in it. Perhaps. Dismay dances across his fingers. Casmeen's, Mimeon's hungry-eyed compatriot steps in. Perhaps you can find an answer where others have failed, and then we can help you. She turns away. You will have our boundless gratitude, revered one.
I'll remember that.
And now, best of luck or something. Fix the clock and circus miner investigate the figures that are trapped inside. I'm gonna need, like, stuff. I'm gonna need, like, some of this stuff, and I'm not gonna have it. But let's see what happens. This complex machine towers over you. Its purpose is unclear, but the three circular faces set into the ground remind you of clocks. Something is wrong with the machine, however. It's partially transparent, shimmering in the air when you look directly at it. The clock faces seem to show several different times at once. Humanoid silhouettes ripple beneath the central clock face. One places his hand against the face as though it were a glass wall. They seem to be watching you. Let's examine the machine. The towering mechanism wavers in the air. Similar to Callistaz, it appears to be in several states at once, though all of the machine states are in the exact same location. You can't touch it either. Your hand passes right through the structure. As you pull your hand away, a memory strikes you as powerfully as if someone took a club to your chest. You are working at the clock. It is no longer transparent, but perfectly solid. There is a noise behind you. So they've come, the three traitors. They think to surprise you, but through the powers of the clock you have foreseen this moment. There is the faintest sound of metal sliding against leather. You slap a hand on the central clock face, activating the clock's arcane powers. You're not sure what it will do to them, but it's better than what they'll do to you. There's a flash. Arcs of energy stretch out from the clock, over your shoulders to your would-be attackers. You don't see what happens to them, but they quickly disappear, along with their screams. As the last shreds of the memory fade, a swirl of energy passes through your body. Cold barbs prick every muscle. Suddenly, tidal forces arc from the clock to three ancient devices in the cultist encampment. The clock recognized something inside you, or maybe vice versa. Either way, you have inadvertently activated the nearby devices. Okay, those three things in the ground, cool.
I'll remember that.
Yes. Yes, and the one in the middle. And that one. Addendum added, fallen to earth. See an addendum.
All right.
The machine wobbles in the air, seeming to be in several states at once. It makes you a little sick to look at it. Reach for the silhouetted figures. Your hand passes straight through the clock face, the figures, and the entire structure. It's as if the entire machine wasn't even there. Okay. So now let's look at these things.
Ready.
As you approach this device, Circus Miner is thrown into chaos. Buildings are on fire. Seriously? People are screaming and running for their lives while armored soldiers hunt them. Are we seeing into the past, or is this happening now? None of them seem to pay any attention to you, though. It's some kind of vision, not reality. Okay. You glance down at the device. A series of images flit across its surface. They don't appear related to the changes around you. You see faces of other people and places, all of them familiar. Look more closely at the changes around you. Circus Minor is under attack. Squads of armored soldiers roam the streets, hunting and killing anyone they find. Mobs of people flee in terror, with only a few hapless souls trying and failing to fight them off. The soldiers are completely encased in jagged metal armor. You can't even tell if they're human. Looking beyond the carnage, the square in the vision looks wildly different. Many of the buildings that are on fire don't exist at all when you step away from the device, having been replaced by other structures. The buildings around the square are on fire, though none of them are remotely the same as the buildings that stand today. You get the feeling the Sagus Cliffs in this vision is ancient. These events could have occurred as much as 1,000 years ago. Examine the images on the surface of the device. As soon as you focus on them, you feel a warmth on your head where your tattoo is. The images respond to your thoughts, slowing and changing at your whim. It's something about your body that allows you to do this, which perhaps means that only you can even see the images. You immediately recognize the pictures as pieces of memory, specifically the three memories you saw in the fathoms of your mind. I got all different memories. Look at the memory in the underwater city. The memory is recent. Two men, both with tattoos like your own, are in an underwater city searching for something. The denizens of the city chase them from the artifact they seek and ultimately surround and capture them. As you review the memory, you get a strange feeling in your mind that you can only describe as a query. The device wants something from you. Suddenly you remember. The memories in the device are possibilities, but you can lock one of the memories here, so it is the only one it displays. You don't remember what purpose that served, though. Look at the memory in the lush valley. Somehow you know the memory is from a long time ago, centuries ago, probably. A man and a woman, born with tattoos like your own, are surveying a lush, secluded valley, seeking an ideal location for a hidden sanctuary. Look at the memory of the city under siege. Somehow you know this memory is ancient. It might have occurred 1,000 years ago. A man and a young girl raced through the streets of Sagus Cliffs. All around them, the city is attacked by a terrible people, the Bot, you recall. The man takes them to an ancient machine somewhere in the city, then he and the girl disappear. I'm thinking this, but let's see what the other device. Oh, I can't. Man, I can't click here and then. Alright. Oh, I should be able to do that.
Without doubt.
She agrees, see that? Alright, let's,
go.
I like to be zoomed in like that. Of course, now I can't see anything. As you approach this device, Circus Minor changes around you. People are dressed differently and speak differently. Whole new structures appear, including an enormous building rising from the edge of the square. You look down at the device. A series of images flit across its surface. They don't appear related to the changes around you. You see faces of other people and places, all of them familiar. Circus Minor looks almost completely different. All the people are dressed strangely, and though they speak the truth, they use many terms and phrases that you don't understand. The square has changed as well. All of the tents are gone. The buildings are more colorful and less weathered. One building in particular rises from the edge of the square, a tower of purple rock, some 50 stories high. A mural is painted on the side, so you can't see the details from here. You know, I'd say the other device, back here, I would lock the city under attack to that one. But I don't know about that.
On it.
And this one in the middle. A strange feeling comes over you as you approach this device, as if someone were sneaking up on you in the corner of your eye. When you look, there's no one there. It feels like something is different, though, but you can't put your finger on what. A series of images flit across the surface of the device itself. They don't appear related to the changes around you. You see faces of other people in places, all of them familiar. The changes are difficult to notice at first, but after a moment, you figure it out. Circus Minor is the same, but the crowd is different. Most of the people in the stalls and buildings are not the same as those you've seen around the square. Those few you do recognize are younger by several years. Okay, I'm thinking go by time, right? So this, the recent memory, goes here. Images of two men in the underwater city are now the only images that play on the surface of this device. They search for something, are chased, and then are captured, over and over again in an endless loop. As soon as the image is locked in place, a ribbon of energy stretches into the air, connecting the control device to the clock. It's almost as if you're looking several years into the past. Different people stand in the stalls and buildings around you, and those few you recognize are notably younger.
I'm ready.
Okay, so this one... This is a little puzzle, I like it. So we got a centuries-old memory and an ancient memory. Ancient. Ancient tiny secret. The images of the man and the girl are the only ones that play across the surface of this device. They run past the enemy soldiers and disappear as at the machine in an endless loop. We shall. Whoops.
On it.
Need to slow down the map scrolling here. Well, not the map, but the terrain. Centuries ago. The images of the man and the woman in the valley are now the only images that play across the surface of this device. They survey the valley in an endless loop. Cool, we got experience. As soon as you lock this third image, a final surge of energy arcs through the air from the device to the clock itself. The clock shines for a moment, then becomes solid, fixed into a single state. At the same time, the device in front of you goes dark. The images disappear, as does the strange view of the city's past. Whoa. Cool. Awesome. Can we let those people out now? Oh, I keep saying addendum, but there's nothing here. The machine is solid now. Each of the three clock faces shows a single time, though none of them point to any time measurement that you understand. You lean closer to the central clock face. Three shadowy figures still lurk within, their face features almost discernible now. Suddenly, the figures surge out of the clock toward you. Intense pressure strikes your head like a steel spike. Then everything goes black. Oops. And we make a note. the hell happened? Oh, these are the figures. Where are we? Clock Fathom.